Hi, I'm here on Books on Toast and I love Books on Toast. No, don't put your books on toast. I'm going to ask that later. Anyway, please subscribe to Books on Toast on YouTube and please watch all the podcasts every Wednesday because I've watched all of them and it's the best thing to do if you love reading. It's the best thing to do if you want to start reading, because I am starting to read so many new kind of books because I started watching the two of them. And I'm so glad they called me here because I am having a major fangirl moment.
Aww.
What do British people say? Apart from bollocks.
Are you enjoying your cup of tea?
Cup of tea is good. Mine's a perfect arse. That's just bollocks, eh?
And they say, Wingardium Leviosa.
Yeah.
That's British.
Oh, Lord.
what are you watching on the telly today?
What a horrible British accent. Yeah. Oh, my God.
Nobody's watching this. They will never let us in their country.
Yeah.
Like, in Kobar Nikalo.
I have seen London once, so I guess I can do this.
I haven't seen London.
Once.
Bahut achha hai. Bahut achha.
I love England.
Hum dugna lagan degi.
Yeah, take it. Lagan degi tu ekdam se Saudi Arabian ban ke bane. But she's a sheikh.
Hasina. I don't know what's happening.
Before this devolves any further, welcome to another episode of the podcast. My name is Anuya.
I'm Sharon.
And we have a new guest with us today. Hi, guest.
Hi. I'm Shruti Guest.
This is Shruti Guest. Shruti Guest, yeah. Tell our viewers what you do for a living.
I'm an actor. Right now I'm doing a TV show called Kumkum Bhagya on ZTV.
Which my mother loves.
Oh, which my mother also loves.
I'm going to take a selfie after this and send it to her.
Me
and
too,
then she'll tell me everything about your family. Because that's what my mother does. Once I spotted Rekha and her driver. And I called her and I said, Mom, I just saw Rekha in her car. And then she proceeded to tell me who the driver was, what her name was, how long she's worked for Rekha. Basically,
wow.
Driver's whole life.
Your mom is Bombay Times.
She
amazing.
Yeah, could be. My name is Anuya Bombay Times Takadar. People don't know that, but it's true.
Great.
Yeah, like Sanjay Leela Bhansali.
No.
So the fun story is that she saw the Rajat Kapoor episode.
Yes, and then all the 20 episodes. Now 21.
Yay!
Ooh, yay! She's on the 21st one. Yes, I saw all of them. I binge watched podcasts.
I know.
It's very
poor
difficult
girl.
To say. I rehearsed.
My sympathies.
No. I think it's very entertaining. All of you must watch it.
Yay, thanks.
And I can say that, right? Maine passive aggressive khela. I tweeted so much about it that they had to call me on the show.
I was like, Sharon, she's famous. What are you doing? Subscribers badhenge.
Exactly. Please, follow. Matlab subscribe.
Thanks.
Follow them.
I love her already.
Yeah.
She's my favorite.
Yeah. I could give my kingdom to her. Yeah.
Yeah.
Your take.
Nobody wants Jogeshwari.
Excuse me. It's
great.
Fine.
Let's come to the question.
Oh no.
Me. Queens.
Queen.
We ask all our guests on the show, what are you reading right now?
Ek hi bol sakte na?
Haan, ek hi. Nahi to ye chalta
rahega. All the light we cannot see.
Anthony Doerr. Yeah.
Yeah.
And what do you think of the book so far?
It's very painful. It's very, very sad. But yeah, it's a good read. Mm. I'd recommend it.
Yeah. I started reading it. It opened only with like blind girl in the middle
blind
of war.
Child.
I'm like, wow, ye Oscar jeetegi.
Yeah, that's the premise.
Iske kabhi picture bani to ye Oscar jeetegi.
Did you finish? Oh, you're in the middle of it right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, I reached the bit. Oh, I can't.
No, but tell us what is it about?
Yeah, briefly.
For people who don't
know. It's about the Holocaust and... There are two characters, one in Paris, the other in Germany, and like she said, the child is blind, she's 12, I'm filtering what all I can't say. And there's this other guy who discovers that he can repair radios and how he will be very useful because radios were essential at that point of time in the Second World War.
Mm.
To fight wars, to communicate.
Main goal of communication, yes.
How they start. So this guy has a sister and they start hearing radio stations that are not allowed then in Germany, and how there's this one night when the sister is crying because she, matlab, they hear that they're bombing Paris, and they cut into a scene where Marie Claire, the character, is. Very sad. but it's really nice also.
I like how I laughed after she said it's very sad. That tells you a lot about my personality.
She could be a good sass, yeah.
But it's a good book. It's a good book.
Please read it. All the light we cannot see.
Right? All the light all we cannot see.
Okay. Sharon, you want to tell us about what the topic of this discussion
yes, so,
is?
Yes, so...
What are you guys reading?
Oh God.
Oh no.
What are we reading?
One book.
We've been on a booker.
We haven't
binge.
Slept for days.
Yeah. No, but I am reading something else that I shouldn't be reading.
What? Archie Comics?
No, why won't I be reading Archie Comics? No, because we have... The problem with having books on toast in our life is that we just don't get the time to read the books we want
to
read.
We really want to read.
Yeah.
So there's a debt pile that's building slowly and taking over my entire house because I just can't get through even half of it.
Yeah.
And cumulatively, it's increasing.
I'm still reading Expanse. I started reading it like...
I saw the first episode after you
mentioned it. Yeah, it's a very good show. But I'm still reading book 3. I'm sure I've brought this up somewhere in some podcast. But like, because I get to read like 10 pages of something I really want to read in between, which is my indulgent reading. Yeah. I know.
Wow.
What have I done to myself?
Wow. No, no, no.
This is the sacrifice
it's
I'm making
for
you.
It's for the greater good.
Yeah, you. But the book that I keep in my bathroom, because that's the one that's my me time, is a book that Sharon gifted to me on my birthday. Where
yes.
She basically, it was not a gift as much as it was a ploy. But she gave it to me and she said, it's time you start reading nonfiction.
Huh? It's amazing. It's the best nonfiction you can ever read.
Nobody can ever make me read self-help. Never.
What?
No. It's
secretly
a book called,
it's
actually really, really fun. It's called, what is it called?
Life on Planet Rock.
Life on Planet
Rock. By Lon M. Fred.
Yes.
He's my mentor. Like,
yeah.
I grew up in Chandigarh wanting to be a music journalist because I looked up to him so much. He's the guy who made the careers of Aerosmith, Guns N' Roses by putting them on the cover of magazines. And
it opens with Guns N' Roses, and now I'm well into the second chapter, which is Metallica. And it's really fun because it makes you just want to start listening to Metallica. I walked out to Metallica 3 days ago just. Because I was
it's
reading
full
about
treadmill music.
It's
I
awesome.
Completely endorse
and
that.
I mean,
Metallica is treadmill music.
It's like Wikipedia, but more fun. You know, I'm doing a bad job, but it's like...
It's a great book.
It's like reading up on the icons that have actually, like, you know, your childhood icons. And so much nostalgia. Because I believe he goes into John Bon Jovi and stuff later, right?
Yes, yes.
So it's just like your childhood music and the stories of their lives. Like, James Hetfield in my head is... James Hetfield, like he's a god.
He's a demigod, absolutely.
And then you read about what his life was actually like and stuff, and it's so interesting and it's like very, very blasé. Like, it's all like sex, drugs, rock and roll, which I love.
Yeah.
Because like I was telling her, she was asking us how we have so much energy. I'm like, we all snort cocaine before we start.
No.
It's only her.
Sharon doesn't snort cocaine.
I don't need anything. I'm just illuminated.
She's Punjabi, guys.
Yeah.
She doesn't need anything. Reading.
So interesting to interestingly that you brought up Lon M. Fred. I'm reading a similar book. It's my favorite essayist. His name is Chuck Klosterman. He was a writer with The Guardian and The Telegraph, and he's British. He's just got this really nice sarcastic sense of humor. It's very, very witty. So he's written a book called Four, which are basically his collections of pop culture interviews that he's done with the biggest celebrities, like people like Val Kilmer, Britney Spears. It's damn nice. It's just, I love that book, man. I've reread that book so many times, and every time I read something really heavy that takes me to a dark place, I go back to this book because I really want to like skim through like fun things.
Mm.
And this guy just does
all
a fabulous job.
All the damn books are like.
Yeah, they've really put us in a bad space.
I feel like that's the idea behind Booker Prizes, you know. Agar ne ye book
depression hai,
mujhe khushi
mil gayi. Depression hua.
Isko long list nahi kar sakte. Yeah, like no, it's too happy. Yeah,
shit. What? I laugh? No, fuck.
We should do this.
Bad pile.
A sketch about what it's like to be a Booker judge.
Like, yeah, no.
All those 8 people who are Booker judges will read. 5 people, sorry. 5 people, right? Anyway, who cares?
Anyway, after much rambling, we are at the topic of why we are here today. So, as
not
you can
to eat
tell,
cake.
drink.
Oh, I see what you just did. Maybe you can. Anyway, the whole topic of our podcast today is British monarchy and colonial historical fiction.
Correct.
It sounds like a mouthful. Yes, yeah. Sounds like a mouthful, but it, I think, has some amazing books that we've read and we unknowingly discovered that we have read, and some that we still have to read. But these are also the books that possibly lay down the ground rules for a lot of Hindi television.
What
is it?
No.
Politics between families.
Thoda hai na.
Marwari families, Gujarati families.
I mean, Downton Abbey essentially is that, right? It's
she's
just like a really
comment.
well produced. कोई नहीं देखता है.
It's okay. हमको कोई नहीं देखता है.
अभी सब देखेंगे.
Sorry,
है कि नहीं ब्रिटिश मनाकी मतलब इज ऑल
किलिंग हैपनिंग देयर इज प्रॉपर्टी ओवरटेक कर लेते हैं
देयर
इट इज बिहेडिंग थोड़ा नहीं है अभी
मतलब लोग डिसअपीयर हो जाते हैं फिर वापस आ जाते हैं 20 ईयर जंप हो जाता है फिर हो जाता है कि नहीं है कि नहीं
नोबडी रियली डाइज और स्टेज डेड
नो हां द ओनली डिफरेंस इज दैट दे हैव न्यू नेम्स यू नो विद दिस होल ब्रिटिश मोनार्की दे जस्ट कीप रिपीटिंग नेम्स
जॉर्ज इज ब्रिटिश मोनार्की का एगॉन टारगेरियन कीप्स कमिंग बैक एवरी टू लाइफ जस्ट अमेजिंग
व्हाई आर वी वेयरिंग टियारास गाइस
बिकॉज़ वी आर ऑल क्वींस
यस इट्स ट्रू
एंड वी एवरी टाइम वी हैव अ कप ऑफ टी वी वेयर अ टियारा
But these are like cheap knockoffs because this is a Books on Toast episode.
Great budgets.
Yeah.
Anywho, guys, coming back to British monarchy and colonial historical fiction. Do you want to, Shruti, quickly start with what is the one book that you've possibly read in the genre that made you sort of think, yeah, this is interesting.
And this we can expand to generic historical fiction. It doesn't
also
have to be
yeah.
this. But if it is, great.
Like कौन सा आंसर करूं पहले
नो शी इज
अ फ्रेंड
मैंने बहुत प्रिपेयर किया था सो द बुक दैट आई हैव रेड इज वुल्फ हॉल दैट्स केप्ट देयर एंड द सीक्वल टू दैट ब्रिंग अप द बॉडीज बोथ ऑफ देम हैव गॉट अ बुक बाय द वे
या
हां लॉन्ग लिस्ट
No, winner.
She won for both of them.
Both of them.
Oh.
She's the only one,
woman,
yeah, who's won for both books in a row. Main book and the sequel.
Okay.
Both
okay.
of them have won bookers.
So what is it about?
Crazy Woman.
Tell us.
So the this book, at the center of the book is Thomas Cromwell, who, matlab maine phir bahar bhi padha, with historical fiction, I think whenever you read historical fiction, you should do some background work.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's the beauty of
the
genre.
Because it will give you some spoilers. Most of them are dead. So we know that. So thoda
So then
Bolna.
So ye Thomas Cromwell jo hai, ye arguably he wasn't like there are lots of historians who say that he wasn't this important.
Mm-hmm.
But in this book he's really important. He has he had done a lot of things like King Henry the Eighth is at the throne at this point of time. I think it was
16th century. I think
16th century, 1535 or something. If I'm not wrong, just sorry if I'm wrong. So yeah, so he was at the throne. He was married to his brother's wife because the brother was dead. So, but he didn't have a male child, so he wanted to get married again. But the church
yeah.
wouldn't allow that. Mm-hmm. So Thomas Cromwell changed everything, made the country believe that the king is more supreme and has more powers than the church, annulled the powers of the church and allowed the king to marry again. But dusri biwi se bhi ladka nahi hua. So then he wanted to marry again. So by the end of the book, first book ends at a point where you, this is very boring.
No, this is go on. The first book ends at a point.
Okay, the book ends at a point where Thomas Cromwell has risen to power. He's the main advisor to King Henry. And King Henry now doesn't want to be with the second wife, Anne Boleyn. this Deo movie, mm. Dada
the Bullying Girl, which is also a book, mm.
which is
by
also
Philippa Gregory.
Yes,
yeah.
Who's also a historical novel author.
Yes, yes.
And so the book ends with.
Are we spoiling it? No.
No, but this is history. It's been referenced.
Yeah.
You guys should know this,
yeah.
guys. Like,
but you but Anne Boleyn is a very
yeah.
interesting character.
Yeah.
You must
she
explore
is.
Her. And even Hilary Mantel, the author of Old Fall, says that this whole Anne Boleyn picture can be written and rewritten.
Yeah.
And rewritten.
Absolutely, absolutely. It's a relationship. It's so complex. In fact, there's a show that comes on Netflix. It's called The Tudors.
Mm.
It's
oh,
based
okay.
on Henry
yeah.
the
oh,
Eighth
this
and
dynasty is the Tudor dynasty.
Yeah, the Tudor dynasty.
We are as a society really obsessed with Anne Boleyn and her sister. What was her name? No. What was sister's name?
Arey.
Oh my God, Scarlett Johansson.
No. The other Boleyn.
That other Boleyn.
Another
Boleyn. Someone slyly Google this and tell us, please. Anyway, The Wolf Hall is also a TV show, guys.
The Wolf Hall is also
yes,
a
yes.
show.
Yes,
so
yes. I haven't seen it.
Huh. Hmm. I tried, that's my copy. And I bought this book with much like, Main padungi. So, Main padungi, okay. I will read this book and I will learn all about like British, the Tudors firsthand and all of that.
Uh-huh.
And I have tried reading the book at least 3 times. I am so amazed that you managed to finish this and bring up the bodies, because the language is so obscure and it's so tough, and half the time I just don't understand what's happening, and it's so like the dialogue is very rambly. There's like pages and pages of just like dialogue. How are you reading it?
Also, the whole part of Cromwell ka jo personal life hai, his wife coming back
yeah.
and the daughter bit is a little difficult to grasp when you're approaching a historical novel. You're generally looking for facts
yeah.
and a little gossipy fact.
So what is that quality about this book that you know you really liked?
I think before this I had no access to British monarchy as such, because we don't study this in school.
Yeah,
yeah. I just picked it up.
Yeah.
Okay.
Uspe likha hua tha, isko booker mila hai, toh mujhe laga this is an
intelligent. Haan, haan,
toh maine, so, and I ended up reading it. And
okay.
then I ended up, because they ended it at like, matlab, bahut hi acha freeze tha episode ka. So that's why I ended up reading the other one.
Okay. So I started watching the show. Unfortunately, even the show is very slow. It's very interesting, but it's very slow. What advice do you have for someone like me who's having difficulty reading the book?
This book?
Yeah.
I just think when you're not interested in a book, you shouldn't like read it.
Okay, fair. I'm sold.
I seriously think that, because someone really made an effort to write a whole story, so you should read it only when you're going to appreciate every
yeah.
sentence of it.
Mm. Yeah.
So, agar nahi acha lagta, koi aur book padho. So I started reading The Name of the Rose.
Hmm.
So I found it interesting, but because uska ye Italian church aur jo bhi unka रॉयल्स थे, बिकॉज आई हैव नो इन्फॉर्मेशन और
कॉन्टेक्स्ट,
सो मेरे को उसमें इतना इंटरेस्ट नहीं आया. ज़्यादा द मर्डर मिस्ट्री में आया, बट आई केप्ट गोइंग बिकॉज आई हैड टू लाइक कम हियर.
फेयर.
हाँ.
आई फील लाइक वी आर पनिशिंग हर.
नो आई लव्ड. आई डिड अ लॉट ऑफ गूगल विकी. फर्स्ट सर्च में जो आता है वही पढ़ के आई हूँ मैं. हाँ. सो आई थिंक यू शुड ऑप्ट फॉर अनदर टॉपिक, बट historical fiction I would advocate, because it's very interesting to read, and also
yeah,
you get
true.
To know a lot of new things.
Mm.
Just if you read a history book about monarchy in Britain, you would read about Henry the Eighth, and
correct.
Thomas Cromwell would be a very little thing in that whole picture, because he was there for 5 years, I think, in his court.
Mm.
But this gives you a different aspect.
So the time of Henry the Eighth in British monarchy history was also a very interesting time in the British monarchy landscape, so to speak, because it had just come after the War of Roses had just finished, and he was preceded by Elizabeth I, and I think that changed a lot of things in British history and even the royal bloodline as well.
Mm.
And in fact, the War of Roses bloodline, which is by Con Iguldin.
Mm.
Con Iguldin.
Con Iguldin.
Con Iguldin.
Con Iguldin.
Con Iguldin.
Con Iguldin. So that's the you know, sort of legendary war between that lasted for 100 years, and it was between it was a civil war. It was a British monarchy civil war between the Lancasters and the Yorks, which is also what the Game of Thrones universe is inspired by. The Lannisters and the Starks are the Lancasters and the Yorks, and there's a character in it called what was her name, man? Margaret of Anjou. She was Cersei Lannister, and you know, she sort of colluded with a lot of royal houses because she wanted her son to succeed, and he was a weakling. So there is a book called The Queen of Last Hope, the story of Margaret Anjou, which is also very interesting. And I think this was like a 200 to 300 year period when so many things happened in British you know, history, and that sort of gave such great content for writers to sort of keep talking about over and over again. So in fact, this was also the time of a lot of mysticism. A lot of things that people could not explain would, you know, sort of blame on paganism and, you know, like some random magic that's happening here and there. And that led to a lot of amazing fantasy as well. So I think this 300 year period or 200 to 300 year period would have spawned too much intense literature that came out.
But I think the most important thing that came out of this period, and the reason why we're all obsessed with it, is because Elizabeth I was Anne Boleyn's daughter.
Yeah.
The reason why she became
Anne and Henry VIII. And she's because the one who became queen of England. And she was the first Protestant queen of England.
Yeah.
It's quite intense. And
because he couldn't have a male heir. I mean, correct. It was like the most feminist.
Yeah. Five wives.
Exactly. And so then there's another spin-off book called Mary Bloody Mary by Caroline Meyer.
And she was actually Bloody Mary. I read this.
She was Bloody Mary.
That's where the legend is born. Does everyone know the legend of Bloody Mary?
Yeah, she used to like behead people. And
you know that if you stand in front of a mirror and say Bloody Mary 3 times, Bloody Mary comes. Yeah.
You conjure the spirit of Bloody Mary and then she will come and
Bloody Mary will come and give you a Bloody Mary. No, that's not. No? That would be cool though. Like, here you go, ma'am. I'm like, this is perfect.
Uske baad behead kar.
Best legend. Uske baad. So, drink to deti hai.
Again, that's some nice. Really, haan. Really interesting literature. That's in fact, there is this show again on Netflix called Rain, which is on Mary, Queen of Scots.
It's a CW show.
It's a CW
show. All CW shows are awesome. But they are
really, really, really funny show. Just because it's endless, it's so predictable, but it's very like
it's
addictive.
Like it's royal gossip girl, guys.
It is totally royal gossip girl. It's so amazing, and but it really reintroduces you to history and the stuff that happened during that time, and you almost want to be there, you know, to sort of be a wallflower and witness all these interesting things that are happening in the landscape. So this, it's so much rich stuff to, you know, play with, and I'm sure the writers had it pretty easy. They're like, okay, call pagal cheese. Let's put it.
The reason why I love historical fiction is because I've realized that our school teaches us history in the worst way possible. Which, I mean, it's shocking because history is so interesting and so rich and so much. I mean, the whole history repeats itself. Like, you can, there is so many lessons to be learnt and so much to be just like imbibed and.
Correct.
And the stories are fantastic.
Yeah.
And that's the thing, when I read it from a novel, I remember it.
You remember it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
From the books, you don't remember it.
Yeah.
You do not.
And I think
and also it's picked.
Correct.
It's picked. This is to be studied. This is to be studied.
Yeah.
This is to be studied.
So they'll tell it to us in the most dry way possible.
Really bad.
Whenever you read a book and some knowledge is a byproduct of that reading process, you retain it better.
Much more. That's true.
That's like mothers feeding you, like, you know, my mother used to put prawn in like bhindi. So you know how you put the vegetable, hide the vegetables in the fun stuff?
Yes.
That's how you teach me. I will learn.
I can't get the prawn out of bhindi image and taste out of my mouth.
See, just
it's delicious.
How
so
you
good.
Cannot take away the fact from fiction in a fiction.
Like prawn and bhindi.
Prawn and bhindi.
Moving away from British
monarchy
for a second. When was the first time you read a book that was described as historical fiction? Can you remember?
In college, I think. Shadow Lines, Amita Ghosh. It's not beautiful. Completely historical, but it keeps going back to the partition of Bengal.
Mm-hmm. Very
so
nicely done. And I think it's a very relevant book because there's so much less literature about what happened in the Bengal partition. And there's so much more that's in the Punjab partition anyway.
Shruti, what's the plot?
So there's this family. Oh, you've asked me a difficult question. I don't really remember what exactly it is. So there's this family and how displacement has happened because of the partition of
Bengal.
And yeah, that's all I can recall.
That's enough.
No, but there are other books by Amitabh Ghosh.
Correct.
That talk about colonized India.
Yes, there is the Glass Palace.
The Glass Palace.
Yeah, which is again very relevant. It's about Burma and Malaysia and everything that happens in Southeast Asia, told from an Indian perspective. Very, very interesting again. It talks about displacement. And of course, why it's relevant to India is because it's about the British policy makers running the length and breadth of the Grand Trunk Road, which is like, which is NH1, guys.
Now.
It was built by who? Which Shah? Which Muslim leader?
Nasiruddin Shah.
Sher Shah Suri. Wow, Sharon, 8th standard history, great.
No, I didn't remember it either.
Yeah, who would remember?
You made me remember, thanks.
You're welcome.
How? Nasiruddin Shah, Sher Shah Suri.
Prawn, bhindi.
See, bhindi. So yeah, so Grand Trunk Road is the road that was built by Sher Shah Suri. It was the first highway in India that connected like a major part of the city, and it was that part of the country. It was pretty much in Delhi. That's all it connected, but Delhi at that point was pretty big. So the Glass Palace, you know, all the policy makers who are making these big decisions about what's going to happen to Burma, Malaysia, and how it's going to impact Indian British Raj was made on the length and breadth of the Grand Trunk Road, also, which is again very interesting.
Burmese royal family was put into exile in Maharashtra, actually.
Correct.
They were for the longest time in Maharashtra.
Why are you looking at me?
Because you laugh.
Prawns.
Because I'm Maharashtrian. Continue.
So they were here, and it's quite sad what happened to them. They couldn't go back. Yeah. And the daughter, and they were rediscovering themselves because when they were there and they were confined to the royal castle, and yahan pe aake, they were not in such a fancy house anymore, but they were discovering themselves as individuals. So again, this is my argument, fact and fiction wala, that you don't know whether this actually happened or it is just.
But the way the situation is built together, it feels like it's plausible. It possibly must have happened.
Guys, I mean, history in so many ways is fiction.
Yes.
Is the retelling of a set of events from the victor's perspective.
And whatever has survived.
I mean, yes, of course, recent history has a lot of
the survivor narrative
physical records.
True.
You know, we were talking about this when we were talking about roots, where they had those oral
storytelling.
The history of like African, they were called griots, I believe.
Yeah.
Was passed from generation to generation by griots who used to keep oral records. How much of that is true? How much of that is personal, is perspective or memory, selective memory? We don't know. We never know. A lot of history that we know as history, that we accept as history, is probably just, I don't know how much of that is fiction.
Possible.
So also, a lot of things get ignored.
Yeah.
For example, the independence. There are so many progressive writers of that time. I'm not even talking about writers now reflecting that. Of that time, the whole Progressive Writers Association, all of them wrote poems and fiction about being betrayed in the name of independence.
Yeah.
But when we read,
we read the victor's version. The majority version. That's the one we read. So you never know.
There's this book called Queen Victoria's Maharaj. It was basically based on this Sikh, the Maharaj of Patiala, Ranjit Singh, his son, Maharaja Daleep Singh. And so before the, or just after the 1857 mutiny, there was this another failed mutiny that happened in 1902 or 1903, which was basically Maharaja Daleep Singh was trying to collude with Italians and the Irish and seeking the support of the Tsars from Russia before the Russian Revolution in order to take over India. And so he did this because at when he was very little and his father died, Maharaja Ranjit Singh died. So Punjab was the last state that was annexed by the British. Mm-hmm. They couldn't win it over because the military was too rabid, too out of control.
Someone
and very, very brave.
Singh and they were like, no.
And that time it was like a fortress, like impenetrable. And the moment Maharaja Ranjit Singh died, British did what they did best at that time, divide and rule. So they went inside the court of Maharaja Ranjit Singh and started playing all the successes against each other. And Maharaja Dilip Singh was 4 years old and he was too young to rule. So obviously the prime ministers of his empire would be the de facto leaders. And Maharaja Dilip Singh was taken away from his family by Queen Victoria, and she literally brought him up like her own son. And there was this whole, you know, period of displacement where they baptized him into Christianity, you know, took him away from everything that defined him as
Theon
a Sikh.
Greyjoy.
Yeah, they without the sad sacrilege and gore. But they changed his personality completely. So he struggled for the rest of his life trying to figure out who he was. And that what that did to Punjab politics and what that did to British being trying to, you know, sort of really cement their rule in India at that time. Because it was the one thing that was always vulnerable to, you know, attacks from the Mongoloids and, you know, the Afghani rulers as well. And which is why British always had an issue, you know, cementing their power in India. And Queen Victoria just completely brainwashed this guy. Like he was the rightful heir, but he wasn't the rightful heir. It was that kind of politics he played. And so the fact that I discovered that there was an almost mutiny that could have happened, and which, you know, like the British figured out the ploy and they, you know, quickly assassinated all the key players. It was just amazing. And, you know, again, I don't know if this could have happened or not, but it's from a perspective. Huh. And if it could have happened, it could have changed history. There would have possibly never been a major Gandhi, you know? Mm. Like, it would have changed the course of Indian independence, I think.
So, that's the thing that historical fiction does.
Yeah.
That they'll fictionalize all of it, but they don't change the outcome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because they can't.
Outcome nahi change. It's like time travel.
Woh tum socho.
Oh my god, I was thinking that. I was thinking about how Doctor Who has these fixed points in time and space that can't be changed.
Yeah.
So no matter what you do,
the outcome is going to be the same.
Yeah.
But it makes you think, right? Like you wonder, like what could have happened.
We've so far talked about two distinct periods in British history.
Raj.
Raj is that was the one.
Hamara Raj.
Yeah.
Aur unkar Sonarki.
One of us was going to make that joke. I was hoping it would not be me. So thanks.
Let's move on.
So two periods.
The Tudors.
Were the Tudors,
And the Victorian.
Yeah. No.
The East India Company.
East India Company and partition
and colonization.
And
the Victorian, hence the Victorian period. She's
The book that I want to talk about is much, much before that. It was in the first century? Year 887, so it's about it's by one of my favorite fantasy authors. I've discussed a trilogy by him called The Warlord Chronicles in our fantasy episode, where he takes Arthur, places him in history, and creates a world where Arthur could have existed. And it's the same thing.
Maybe
it's
Arthur did exist. He was
a
hedge knight.
Yeah, exactly. That's what. No, he was never a hedge knight. So
he was a ruler.
He was a ruler, he was a prince.
Correct.
But in this, he's an illegitimate prince in the Warlord Chronicles.
Oh, he's a bad. He's Jon Snow.
Yeah, pretty much. But that's not the trilogy that I'm talking about. In fact, the series that I'm going to talk about is 10 books. I think it's 9 or 10 books. Yeah. And that focuses on like the Saxons. It's called the Saxon Tales, the series.
Mm.
The first book is called The Lost Kingdom. And it's about the ruler of Northumbria and his fights with the battles that they fought against the Vikings or the Danes. They were Vikings when they were warriors and Danes when they were traders. So he touches upon Christianity versus paganism in everything he writes. Even in Arthur, Merlin was a pagan sorcerer.
Yeah.
Right? And Nimue, the Lady of the Lake, is his protege. So stuff like that. So it's very, very interesting for us also because we've all grown up in a world where Christianity existed, and this is a world where Christianity is just being like, just started its takeover of, you know, the Western civilization. Yeah, Romans have gone, and there is this paganism is everywhere, and there is this very clear void left behind by the Roman kingdom. So he is just an astounding writer. Like, I mean, the minute he starts writing, he takes you on adventures, and you are in that world, because he's just so much fun to read. And again, one of the best ways to learn about any history. And you don't go that far back. You go into Elizabethan, Victorian, and partition and colonialism, but you've never, or it's like gods, you know, it's gods. But this era of history that he tackles, in fact, the hero is called Uhtred. His real father told him that they have descended from a line of Saxons where the king was King Uhtred. So he took that as the basis of the story, and he wrote. Okay, so while we're on this topic of making history interesting, I have to recommend a podcast. It's by this guy named Dan Carlin. And I'm amazed that I'd recently discovered him, because he's very famous and he's made a lot of podcasts. So it's like you'll spend the rest of your life listening to them. But he has this thing called Hardcore History, where he's spoken a lot about British, the stuff that we are already talking about as well. And he's done this whole series on Churchill, which is also very interesting. But the one that I'm listening to right now is called The Wrath of Khans, which is about Genghis Khan. And again, see, Mongolia is not something that we pick up and read on a regular basis, right? And Genghis Khan, even though he's... I don't remember reading about Genghis Khan in our school books. I remember reading about him in Childcraft. You know, they had a book which was dedicated to world history, and that's where they mentioned Genghis Khan. So my knowledge of him is so limited. And because of that, I sought out that podcast and I listened. It's so interesting, guys. Please, please listen to Hardcore History. It's the best way to learn about history. You know, I've tried reading a lot of historical non-fiction. My father once gave me Rise and Fall of the Third Reich. Yeah. That book is so dry. It is so horribly dry.
But all true stories.
Yeah, but I mean, why can't they make it fun? Why can't they just tell it like...
I don't think it was a fun time.
No, it's... Oh, please. Are you telling me there is World War II... There is World War II non-fiction that's written in a very, very interesting way.
Yeah.
No, non-fiction. There is one book about spies, which I don't remember, which is just about the spy network in World War II and how it helped them win the war. But anyway...
Dan Carlin.
I will link to his website, Nietzsche. Please go check it out.
Yeah. And just wanted to quickly talk about one last book, since we were talking about...
I'm trying to
British
get her to not talk.
Colonial history in India is, of course, Midnight's Children by Salman Rushdie.
Mm.
It, magical realism, of course, but it talks about the partition and India's emergency, and of course, our beloved Sanjay Gandhi. Must read that book. It's amazing, really. Yeah.
Yes.
Why is it called Midnight's Children, Sharon? Tell the people who don't know.
It's about the children born at the midnight. Stroke of
midnight hour.
When India
14th August 1947.
Yeah. Two farishtas fell from the sky. Okay.
The war, battle of languages, or war of languages that happened, that divided Maharashtra and Gujarat into
Correct.
Two separate
states. It's just a very...
Bindi, prawn.
And I... Sorry for being unaware. Before I read Midnight's Children, I didn't know that happened.
Why are you sorry?
Just.
It's okay.
For being...
That's why we read,
not
right?
informed.
That's why we read.
For facts.
To inform ourselves, yeah. Yes. Con Eagledon, whose book you see here, maybe.
Con
Eagledon.
Again.
He has written a great series about Genghis Khan, since we were talking about him. Yeah, okay. If you want to pick him up. And now, I think it's time for us to move to the
clickbait
round.
Alright.
Clickbait round
for
today is actually really, really fun. What we've decided to do with you, Shruti.
Since you are queen.
Yeah, since you're queen.
We are
all queens. But
we
today
are
you are queener than us.
You're queener.
You're queenie.
Sometimes I queen, sometimes you're... I...
Queen. Oh, to queen or not to queen?
Queen Latifah.
Queen, nahi. Queen ki saas bhi kabhi
bolte.
Oh!
No.
Oh no.
Queen ghar ghar ki.
You know, this is really funny because my head is saying queef. You know what a queef is?
Oh my god.
See how we educate our guests. We tell them new things that they don't know.
I don't know what queef is.
Are you sure? You want me to tell you? It's very dirty.
Try.
Wo kumkum bhagya type jo hai na wo अंकल आंटी देख रहे होंगे
यंग चिल्ड्रन वॉच आवर शो मे बी एंड वांट टू रीड
बुक्स दे शुड नो व्हाट अ क्वीफ इज गाइस सो अ क्वीफ इज बेसिकली अ वजाइनल फार्ट
व्हिच इज नॉन गैसी
सो समथिंग दैट गोस ब्र बट फ्रॉम द वजाइना इज द क्वीफ यू आर ऑल वेलकम यू आर वेलकम थैंक्स दैट फॉर वाचिंग द शो
ऑल क्वीफ्स
एवरीबॉडी
क्वीफ्स आई
मीन ऑल वुमेन क्वीफ मेन डोंट क्वीफ
Because they can't.
Because they can't.
It's logistically sad. Not
it's
possible.
It's fun feeling. Anyway, moving on. We don't need a clickbait round now. Like this is.
Ho gaya.
Is there? We'll put this is our promo.
Queen. She said it so sweetly.
Okay, that brings
us
to
God,
the end
of this really electric and electrifying podcast. And thank you so much, Shruti, for joining us.
For tweeting at us.
Yes, and talking about
He's
this.
She's actually tweeting at this.
Yeah, she did like 10. After a while, it got embarrassing. I had to call my social media manager and be like, "What is who is this person?"
My next step
I don't have a social media
Next step, though, I would have had to resort to guns or
violence.
Violence, yeah.
पीछे है कैमरा पीछे मुड़ गया गन ले
There's a person holding a gun.
And it's not very godly. Sorry, Devgan joke.
Oh my God, amazing.
Wow. Devgan.
Polite laughter. God gun. It's the God gun. God killer.
Yeah. So please, if you have more British historical fiction novels that you want to recommend.
Yeah, are immense and I'm sure we haven't discussed them. But too bad, guys.
Yeah. We can't read everything.
Go read them. Yeah.
Because we have lives.
Yeah.
Matlab, I have life.
I will sit and read.
Sharon has a husband. Hey, speaking of that, Shruti, what is the favorite comment?
Oh my God, you guys!
Books on Toast video has received, Shruti. Why don't you tell us?
Because I also read the comments.
Yes.
That's how big a fan I am.
She is.
पहले मैं खुद को sell कर लूँ. The most favorite comment, whoever you are, I'm sure you're watching this.
We love you. We love you.
Someone who, no, you don't have to say that. You have to say something else. Someone who posted that very sexy.
Are you sexier than queef?
Oh, sex is the queef of the mind. Dimagi queef. It's the other version of
Dimagi queef. That's another t-shirt we should have.
Dimagi queef.
Dimagi queef. But anyway.
Kahan thi main?
Haan.
Dimagi
queef.
So someone commented saying, it's very sexy when Sharon says coagulate.
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 Coagulate, yes.
Oh.
I don't even remember the sentence she used.
She trumped it. So clearly we have a winner.
You guys should tell us, Shruti's coagulate is sexier than
my
coagulate.
Is Shruti's coagulate sexy
or 10 marks, this question, 10 marks.
In your next paper on historical fiction.
On your next paper on historical fiction.
Now you are Masa, yeah. That's happening. So subscribe to our channel, guys.
Please subscribe
to Books on Toast. And watch all the episodes because these are some of the best books that if you want to start reading also, this is the best podcast to watch. Please.
It's also the only podcast to watch, so you know.
Yeah, just don't watch anything else on YouTube.
Kushi ke
Yeah, else. Fuck those AIB guys. What? Nobody watches that shit.
No, nothing else. Who watches movie trailers also?
No. Nobody cares about that. Watch our channel.
Yeah.